Dobrý den, přátelé.
Hello, dear friends. Welcome again to watching a regular online series. He's coming soon. As you already know, it's a series about the rapture. And I'm here again with Sergei Mihal, who wrote the book He's Coming Soon. In the book, I found a very important topic called Like a Thief at Night. Yes, coming of Christ throughout the whole Bible is described like a thief at night. And this shows us two things, two key things of this story. The first one is that he will come unexpectedly. Who awaits a thief? Nobody. He will come so unexpectedly and so surprisingly that Jesus calls this day a trap for the world. He will come like a thief and take his church. But this also documents that he will steal something from the world. But he will not be the real thief. He will just take what is his. He will not take what doesn't belong to him. He will take only the thing that is his. Moreover, the prophet Joel, chapter 1, verse 15, says that, "Behold the day of the God which is near, and he will come from the Almighty like a theft." I was considering calling this book "A Robbery of the World" rather than "He's Coming Soon." Because the day of the rapture will be a robbery of the world. When God, the Lord of the heavens and the earth, will send his Son to take those who are his from this earth. But in the eyes of the world, it will look like a robbery, as if somebody has robbed the world and took something unexpectedly, surprisingly, urgently. And Jesus calls this day a trap for all who live on the surface of the earth. And we know, as far as a trap is concerned, if you enter a trap, you can't enter just half of the trap or just the end of the trap. If Jesus protects us from the trap and wants us to escape from it, we can't be saved from just half of the trap, or we can't be saved at the end of the tribulation or in the middle of tribulation, but before the tribulation, before the whole world enters it. And that points out how serious the moment of rapture is. It will be like a thief at night. I have always thought the thesis about him coming unexpectedly, and that's true, he will come unexpectedly because nobody knows. Interesting is how Jesus navigates us from being protected from that. He says, "Behold, and watch your heart not be weighed down by carousing, drunkenness, and anxieties of life, and this day would come upon you suddenly like a trap, as it will come like a trap on all that live on the surface of the earth." That means my heart shouldn't be focused on what to drink and what to eat, and about the finances and bills and trouble that need to get their lamps ready, that need to fix their lamps. There is time coming when we need to spiritually fix spiritually. I have just recently realized that the knowledge of the oil supply became clear to me. We always thought this was about relationship to God, about holiness, purity. But the purity is represented by the virgins itself. When you say a virgin, that points out to purity. So we can't think of them as being dirty. This points out their purity. So what is the oil supply? This cannot only be holiness, but this is more about the supply of the oil. Now I can see that probably the oil supply is a reaction to the groom coming. If you hear that the groom is coming, some people shine, some people are eager, some people love God sincerely and are excited, and the oil is in them. But somebody who is saved by the blood of Christ, who serves God, preaches the gospel, suddenly hearing about this news, loses the oil, is angry with God. The Lord should come now. I have so much work to do. We need to spread the gospel to the world. We need to change the world. But thinking about the Lord coming tomorrow, the world falls apart. And that's the oil supply that they lose suddenly. With the vision of Christ coming tomorrow, taking the church, their spirit, their soul is frightened. And I can't explain this, I can't understand it, that a bride who awaits her groom and receives a news about the groom coming, taking her home, the bride suddenly gets frightened and that identifies her not having the oil supply. No matter she serves the church, no matter she thinks about the mission, and no matter she wants to share the gospel with the world, but their relationship to Christ is somehow strange, as if Christ was a second-handed. More important is what I do for Christ, not Him, but the work for Him. I am persuaded that this day will show this off. The day will be like a mirror of who I am or of who Jesus is for me. Because the bride is awaiting this day, can't wait it, speaks about it all the time. But the one who doesn't have the oil supply doesn't talk about that day, but talks about the work for Christ. You can see that all these 10 virgins are together, they coexist together. They're one to each other. And suddenly a scream comes out. The groom is coming. And some of them run towards the door, and others file is going out. They're puzzled, they lose their oil. It's a bad news for them. I opened up the book today and found a topic about those taken and those left behind. It's one of the key topics of the book, because the meaning of this book is to talk about those taken and those left behind, so that it may warn us and prepare us, and in the end, to bring hope to those left behind. But we would not like to talk about the second chance, but about the first hope. Billy Graham recently has written a book called You Don't Have to Be Left Behind. You can put Jesus first in your life today. And that identifies those being taken, that they put Jesus first in their lives. So the moment Jesus comes on the clouds, He will separate His bride, His wife, from the rest of the world. Coming secondly to the Mount of Olives, He will separate the wheat from the chaff. So the rapture is about Jesus separating His people from the rest of the world. So if you want to be taken, you need to become a bride of Christ. You need to have the oil supply. You need to long for Him coming back, to be with Him forever. And that makes you the expecting one to be taken home with Christ. Because what makes us worthy is putting Jesus first in our life. He put us first. Dying on the cross, He put you and me first above all the things in His life. And He told to the Father, Father, may Your will be done I am dying for anyone who believes in me. And if we can't put Christ first, the wedding wouldn't be fair. Jesus would marry somebody who he loves the most, but they don't. They love something else more than Christ. It can be a ministry for Christ, wealth, banks, assurances. But that's what it's all about throughout the whole book. That we rearrange our priorities in life. Huge events take place in Prague and in Bratislava with desire to reach our nations with the gospel. And this is a legitimate desire. It's a legitimate call from the Lord to do so. But what is more legitimate is to connect this news with the news that Christ is coming back. We can't separate this. And if we do so, it's like not telling the whole truth about Christ. It's like telling, if you believe in Christ, He will prepare a satisfied life for you. And maybe in hundreds and millions of years He will come and everything will be fine. But Jesus is something who is coming. The first church already believed so. And if you don't believe in Him, you will be lost. Because no one and nothing else can save you but the coming Jesus. He is not the oncoming Jesus. He is the one who is coming, the one who was, is, and yet to come. If we preach the gospel who is not coming, then that my question is, who are we preaching about? Yes, there is somebody who will give me gifts, who will help me, hallelujah. And we don't realize that we need to preach about the Christ who will take your previous life. You will have nothing but Him. Do you want such Jesus? If yes, you will get Him. But if you want a banker, somebody who will take care of your illnesses, of your prosperity, of your comfort, then it's not the Jesus of the Bible. The Jesus we need to preach about is the one who is coming soon. Some people say, I am often offended by people saying, you are not sharing the gospel, you are just preaching about Jesus coming. I can't remember separating this. Every time I speak about the rapture, I speak about coming Christ. And as I speak about Him, I also speak about salvation. I say this in my chess club, in my car, to anyone whom I meet. Jesus is your Savior, and He is the one who is coming soon, and who will end the history of this world, opening up a millennial kingdom where He will reign like a legitimate king, the only one who will gather all the nations under His reign. The second part of this book is dedicated to this topic. The first part is dedicated to the time before the rapture, and the second part is dedicated to the period after the rapture. I made a lot of remarks. It's about crazy and clever virgins, about Philadelphia and Laodicea. We all know those are letters to Philadelphia and Laodicea. What is interesting, Jesus doesn't say He invites us for breakfast or for lunch, but He invites us for dinner. It's the dinner at the wedding of the Lamb in heaven. Jesus promised this to Philadelphia as well as Laodicea. To Philadelphia, He said, because you kept my word, I will take you from everything that is common upon the world and take you for the dinner. The Laodicea, which is disobedient to God, has a lot of different problems than the wedding of the Lamb, we can see that Christ is not even in the center of that church. And we know that word that when two gather together, I am in their middle. Laodicea meets together, but Christ is not in the center. Despite that, God doesn't judge them, doesn't deny them, but patiently and urgently knocks on the door and says, if anyone hears my voice and opens up, he will dine with me and I will dine with him. The last time, in one of the previous parts, we talked about Enoch. And I really enjoyed that topic because the Bible says that Enoch walked with God and then God took him and he was no more. It appears to me that people must have seen that rapture in one moment that was very quick. Enoch was not there. Apostle Paul also speaks about Enoch. He makes it more specific, and he says that Enoch walked with God, and God liked him, and God took him. Enoch is the seventh generation from Adam. After Adam was cast out of paradise, Enoch was the seventh man to be born in the genealogy set. Enoch was born in 622. After Adam was cast out of paradise, when the flood came, it was in the year 656. But Enoch was not on this planet anymore. Enoch was taken in the 365th year of his life. And when he was 65, his son Methuselah was born. And his name means that when he dies, in that year it will come. The flood will come. So Enoch was the one to know about the flood of the world. He saw it in a dream when he was 12 years old. And once he had that dream, he told his father, Daddy, I saw the flood of the world. And Jareb, his father, tells him, Enoch, when God showed you the flood of the world, then go and pray that mankind would survive and would be saved. As we see Enoch growing up, and Enoch had Methuselah, Methuselah had Lamech, and Lamech had Noah, we see that Enoch was a great-grandfather of Noah. Methuselah was a grandfather of Noah. So Methuselah and Lamech helped Noah build the boat. So they were applying the things that they learned from their fathers and grandfathers. So we can see that the message was inherited from generation to generation, as we see it in church now, as the second coming of Christ has been inherited since the time of disciples. This is the similarity between the story of the flood and the second coming of Christ. It's like an inheritance of those who trust in God. We can see that 120 years before the flood came, and it came in 1656, God comes up to Noah and tells him to build the ark because the flood will occur in 120 years. And as he starts to build the ark with his family, we can also see from what Peter says that Noah is preaching to his surroundings about what he's doing. He's speaking about the judgment that will come upon the world and about atonement. And as I was thinking about that, Noah hadn't been inviting anyone to the ark. I was so surprised by this thought that I finally realized that God gave the sizes of the ark to Noah. In that way, he somehow framed Noah's preaching, and it framed whom the Noah will take into the ark. God didn't ask Noah to fill the ark. Just imagine 100,000 or a million people would believe in God. The ark would be small for such an amount of people. What was he actually doing? God would have never have him do an impossible thing. And Peter says about Noah that he was a preacher of righteousness. This brings me to one conclusion, that when the judgment came on the people after the flood, I can see huge God's mercy. I can see an allegory with Christ bringing church to heaven, that it's similar to the days of Noah and Lot, that after he takes church home, the big strikes will come upon the world. After those 40 days of rain, the floodgates of heaven opened, and also the voids. And the whole world was so flooded in 40 days that even the highest mountains were flooded. But at that time, the people who were not listening to Noah, they cried and repented. And they were looking for God's face and were confessing their sins and were asking for forgiveness. And that I am saying the truth is also supported by Peter, who says that when Jesus was crucified, he went down to the empire of death, not only to take over the government, over the empire of the death, or to take the keys, but also to help the people who were enslaved in the empire of death, who didn't obey God in the time of God's mercy when Noah was preaching. But Jesus came down there to take out those people who drowned in those waters and repented and were seeking God's face. God took those people. And when Jesus went down there, he took them out. And the same thing can be applied to us, that no one can come to Jesus unless they are driven by the Father. And the same thing will happen within the rapture. A lot of people will understand that everything we preached about Jesus, just like the people around Noah understood, these people will cry and they will look for God. They will have desire to find Him. And God will put them down and will try to save them. But not in the ark, but in the tribulation of the world.